In this update, we're going to examine a few, though certainly not all, of the lies told by the ATF and FBI in their official independent investigations of Waco. We invite inquiries from the media. In fact, we dare the media to finally publicize the truth. And we challenge each member of Congress to demand and conduct congressional inquiries into the events in Waco. But first, we're going to show you why the government lied. This photograph was taken at the front door of the Branch Davidians' house the morning the ATF arrived. If you examine it carefully, you can see there was a child outside as the ATF began firing wildly. The features of the child in the photograph were deliberately blurred by someone to prevent recognition. This alteration can be seen by the naked eye examining a print from the negative. The alteration is more proof of the depths to which people have stooped in covering up the truth about what happened that day. The child has been identified as probably being Cyrus Koresh, David Koresh's 8-year-old little boy. After the raid, these agents were captured on film running with a small body to an ambulance. If these agents were carrying an adult, you would see legs or some part of the body extending below or beyond the agents themselves. Other children were killed that day, too, as a helicopter fired down into the house. Annetta Richards, one of the grandmothers who came out with the children, told the world that she and the children had been fired down upon by the helicopters. Children who left Mount Carmel the day after the raid drew pictures for the psychiatrists who interviewed them.
And then as I asked her, is there anything else, she took her crayon and went. And I asked what that was, and she said that was bullets.
More proof that the helicopter had fired down on a room full of women and children. Dick DeGuerin, the attorney who entered Mount Carmel during the siege, also said he saw the room and bullet holes where a helicopter had sprayed the roof of the home, killing a nursing mother and children in the room. Unfortunately, he didn't share this information with the public until after the fire, nor did his former college classmate from Baylor University, FBI Director William Sessions. And in the tape-recorded conversations between the Branch Davidians and the McLennan County Sheriff's Deputy, known as the 911 tapes, the Branch Davidians frequently refer to the helicopters firing in on them from overhead, and they are clearly terrified of them.
There's chapel with more of them.
What?
Another chopper with more people and more guns going off. Here they come.
All right. Wayne, come.
More fiery. That's not us. That's them.
Okay. All right.
David Koresh, in the 911 tapes and in a radio interview, says that the ATF killed his children.
No, let me tell you something.
Yes, sir.
You see, you brought a bunch of guys out here and you killed some of my children. We told you we wanted to talk.
This photograph shows one of the helicopters used by the government on the day of the raid. This helicopter has a .308 machine gun mounted in the doorway. Notice the words United States Army on the tail, contrary to the government's claims that the three helicopters at Waco were unarmed National Guard helicopters. Remember how government officials frequently told us that the Branch Davidians were abusing the children, as if this raid was for the children?
What impressed me is that the Bureau, time after time, asked Koresh for some evidence that the children were okay. The Bureau sent in videotapes asking Koresh to do something to prove that the children were okay. Negotiators consistently asked that the children be sent out. We did not receive verification that the children were okay.
The report admits that Janet Reno lied when she told us that David Koresh had refused to send down videotapes showing the condition of the children. It says, that night, the Davidians sent out a videotape of the children in the compound. The negotiator's log shows that when the tape was reviewed, there was concern that if the tape were released to the media, Koresh would gain much sympathy. These two men, Olayitan Oyetumbi and Gary Spaulding, drove day and night from South Bend, Indiana, to bring baby food and chicken feed requested by the Branch Davidians to Mount Carmel. As you can see, they were very peaceful. Yet they were arrested. Their crime? Bringing baby food to Mount Carmel. This occurred only 3 days before Janet Reno claimed that the government assault with tanks was out of concern for the children. In these scenes from the day of the fire, shown in Waco, the Big Lie, you can see that a tank was over the outdoor underground tunnel for more than 2 hours that morning. You can see agents getting in and out of those tanks over the underground bunker. And you can see that smoke was pouring from the underground bunker less than 5 minutes before a tank smashed the end of the house. The tank collapsed the house down onto the trap door to the underground bunker. Anyone in that bunker was trapped. No one in the house would be able to run to the safety of the bunker to escape the deadly gas and flames. Autopsies showed that many children died of blunt trauma. On the Maury Povich Show, Coroner Rodney Crowe told how those children died.
3 children had blunt force trauma, but it was from the falling concrete in the bunker that fell on them. There's an opening in the top of the bunker, 8 feet approximately in diameter, and large chunks of concrete fell on these people.
21 of them died of gunshot wounds, and the rest died of smoke inhalation and, of course, suffocation due to being buried in debris when the bunker collapsed.
So now we know why the Treasury Department, the White House, and ATF and Department of Justice were so desperately lying to us all along. We were told every day that this raid, the gassing, the attack on the house, and the destruction of evidence, had all been because of concerns for the children.
We had concerns for the children.
The big lie continues. The ATF is under the direct control of the Treasury Department. As head of the Treasury Department, Lloyd Benson would be ultimately responsible for any wrongdoing by ATF. Yet it was Benson who chose the so-called independent investigators. Each of the 3 so-called independent investigators Benson chose had been involved directly in the planning, execution, or cover-up of the police firebombing of the headquarters of a group called MOVE in Philadelphia that resulted in the fiery deaths of MOVE members in a situation similar to Waco. According to the introductory letter from Treasury Secretary Lloyd Benson to President Clinton, the committee's report was supposed to be a vigorous and thorough investigation of the events leading to the loss of law enforcement and civilian lives near Waco, Texas, on February 28, 1993. But on the cover of the report, it doesn't say it is a thorough investigation of the events in Waco. It says it is an investigation of Vernon Wayne Howell. Even in the Treasury's report, which was not released until September 1993, the ATF persists in calling the Branch Davidian House the heavily armed fortress-like compound, even though by now we have all seen that the house was a simply constructed Masonite exterior frame home. And on page 3, it begins, "in memory of," and then names each of the deceased ATF agents. There doesn't seem to be any question of whether this was going to be an independent or vigorous and thorough investigation of the events on February 28, 1993. The overall perspective for the raid was spelled out in an internal Treasury Department memorandum from Christopher Kyler, Assistant Treasury Secretary for Enforcement, to Mike Langan before the raid, in which Kyler matter-of-factly says that the agents will be raiding a Branch Davidian Seventh-day Adventist church. It doesn't get any plainer than this. They've spelled it out for us. The government set out to conduct a military assault on a church. This same memorandum specifically says that the ATF raid will be assisted by state, local, and military authorities. Again, spelling it out for us, every level of government participated in this military terroristic attack on a church full of 140 men, women, and children. The results of the supposedly independent investigation, known as the Treasury Report, were released September 29, 1993. It berated ATF leadership for failing to cancel the raid when they knew the ATF had lost the element of surprise. ATF Director Stephen Higgins and others were forced to resign with full pensions. The ATF tried to make it seem that they were admitting error by blaming leaders for losing the element of surprise.
And we had our plan down, we had a diversion down, all were put into effect, and they were waiting.
What we had was someone who eliminated the element of surprise, which is what we needed, and in so doing, our agents walked into an ambush.
The main problem we had, I don't believe, is that we were outmaneuvered or outplanned. The problem we had is that we were outgunned. You know, they had bigger firearms than we had. They were able to shoot through doors, and due to that, you know, a lot of our agents were hurt.
The ATF had the Branch Davidians under surveillance for over a month from the house across the street. They knew the land was completely flat. There could be no possibility of surprising the Branch Davidians with 100 men arriving in cattle cars visible from miles away. The Treasury report admits that ATF's own public relations person, Sharon Wheeler, contacted several Dallas television stations several days before the raid. The lie that the ATF lost the element of surprise was aided by the media while showing us this very edited piece of footage of the first day of the raid, over and over, as an announcer would say, the ATF was met with a hail of gunfire. And just in case you somehow hadn't heard the ATF claim that the Branch Davidians were waiting for the ATF, within a week after Mount Carmel was burned to the ground, NBC television aired the government's official propaganda as a movie, showing Branch Davidians at all the windows with guns waiting for the ATF to arrive. If you have doubts that this was propaganda, consider that the Treasury report repeatedly states that U.S. Army Special Forces planned the raid and trained the agents. The ATF raid leader is former Special Forces, and even advisors to the independent investigators included Delta Force Special Forces. Then, get a copy of this Army Psychological Operations Training Manual, a how-to on propaganda that says that making a movie is an important element of military occupation. Another lie told by ATF in the official report says, on Wednesday, February 24th, ATF rescheduled its raid from Monday, March 1st to Sunday, February 28th, because it expected the Tribune-Herald to publish its Sinful Messiah series on Sunday. The warrants were signed on February 25th and expired on February 28th, the day the raid took place. The raid was never moved up a day, and these warrants weren't filed with the court until March 1st either. The ATF is lying when it claims they lost the element of surprise, and the ATF is lying when it says it moved the raid up a day so as not to lose the element of surprise. So were the Branch Davidians waiting for them, or is that a lie too? John McLemore is a reporter for KWTX Channel 10 Television in Waco, Texas. Both he and cameraman Dan Maloney were present at Mount Carmel on February 28th, the day ATF raided Mount Carmel, and they claim to have filmed the scenes of the initial raid. In one of the first Associated Press newspaper reports that came across the wire services on February 28th, John McLemore is quoted as saying, "They came right in, parked right by the front door, and made a frontal assault on the building." Another article across the AP wires on February 28th said that, according to witnesses, federal agents hid in livestock trailers as they drove up to the compound. As three National Guard helicopters approached, the 100 law officers stormed the main home, throwing concussion grenades and screaming, "Come out!" There is no mention of any barrage of gunfire from the Branch Davidians in these first reports. And in actuality, the Branch Davidians reacted the way any American would react when his home was broken into by armed terrorists. They first called the police. They dialed 911.
911, what's your emergency?
There are men, 75 men around our building.
Okay, just a moment.
In the tape recordings of these conversations, we can hear the fear and distress of Wayne Martin as he says,
"Yeah, tell them there are children and women in here and to call it off."
Brad Branch, a Davidian who was also interviewed by phone, described it this way.
When they jumped out, David opened the door and put his hand out and says, "Now hold on, we have women and children in here." And bullets started hitting the door and all through the foyer. And that's when we slammed the door.
The Treasury report also says Koresh appeared at the front door and yelled, "What's going on?" From that statement in the report, we have an admission by ATF that Koresh came to the door. The Treasury report next claims that the agents identified themselves, stated they had a warrant, and yelled, "Freeze and get down." Examining the official report for plans for the raid, there is absolutely no plan for any agent to first knock at the door or announce the agent's presence. The ATF planned the entire raid using dynamic entry teams, who were to burst through the front door, underground bus, and upstairs windows simultaneously. David Koresh, in an interview with CNN, said it happened like this.
They started firing at me. And so what happened was is that I fell back in the door and the bullets started coming through the door. And so then what happened was some of the young men and stuff started firing on them. And I was already hollering. I was saying, "Go away." You know, I was hollering, "Go away. There's women and children here. Let's talk."
The Treasury report next says, But Koresh slammed the door before the agents could reach it. Gunfire from inside the compound burst through the door. The force of the gunfire was so great that the door bowed outward. Then gunfire erupted from virtually every window in the front of the compound. This photograph, taken by a Waco Tribune Herald reporter, proves that all of these claims in the Treasury report are absolute lies. Since the door is still cracked open, it obviously was never bowed outward from the force of shots inside, which would have slammed the door shut before any bowing could occur. If any shots had been fired from inside, the exit holes of the bullets would have split and chipped paint and the outside of the door. The holes in the door are neat and uniform and are obviously holes made by bullets shot from outside by ATF. There are no Branch Davidians at any of the windows. This scene of the front door was also filmed from a side view by KWTX Channel 10. Here, too, you can see that no one is shooting at the agents behind cars at the front door. No bullets are hitting any of the car windshields or throwing up dirt around the agents. In additional footage of the initial raid that was released through the media, we see the agents climbing the ladders to the roof on the side of the house. These agents were supposed to be on the roof within 33 seconds after arrival, according to the plan. Machine gun fire is clearly heard in the forefront coming from the ATF. ATF agents yell, "Too much live fire," telling their agents to quit firing wildly. Many of these agents are carrying MP5 submachine guns and rifles. Notice that no one is shooting at these agents either as they climb the ladders. Once on the roof, these agents do not come under fire, even as they laboriously break into a window on the roof, while a fourth agent lies on the roof. Listen carefully to the background sounds as we watch this again. A helicopter is close overhead, but there is a cut in the film from a close shot to a wide shot, and the helicopter sounds change abruptly. The ATF has claimed none of its helicopters had guns that day, but in each segment where a helicopter approached the house, we also found a cut in the tape footage.
I'm rolling. Go back to the car and get me another tape then.
This agent is carrying a smoke grenade. He has already drawn his 9mm handgun before he goes in the window. Notice that he is also carrying grenades on a belt on his leg. The agents toss smoke grenades into the room before they enter the window.
Go back to the car and get me another tape then.
After these agents get in the window, there is an obvious glitch in the tape here too. American Justice Federation did not make any of these cuts in the videotape. We are showing you the tape segments exactly as we found them. We can prove this tape was shown by other TV stations with exactly the same cuts in it. Reporters for KWTX Channel 10 in Waco, Texas, supposedly shot this video the day of the raid. The vice president of news for KWTX Channel 10 is Virgil Teeter, and his phone number is 817-776-1330. Call him and ask why he has not released all the video footage to the American public, and why the footage that has been released has been so badly altered, and who did the altering. The film picks up again with this agent tossing something into the room.
How many bells would we run out for?
Now in Waco, the Big Lie, we showed you how this agent first tosses a grenade into the room. He withdraws his hand, then shoots into the room. Shots begin coming out of the room. He is then hit by a round in the back of the helmet. He falls to the roof, grabbing the back of his head. Then he gets up and slides rapidly down the ladder. One of the problems with this tape footage is that the sounds do not coincide with what can be seen. Notice that in the segments immediately before and after this scene, you can hear a lot of noise in the background.
I'm rolling.
Don't turn the camera off.
Go to the back of the car and get me another tape then.
First, let's turn off the sound altogether and examine where the bullets come from. The agent tosses a grenade. He pulls back the curtain and fires into the room. Then shot one comes from inside the room. Shot number two comes from overhead. Numbers three and four come from inside the room. Number five makes three holes at once from the inside. Six goes up from inside. The agent fires again. Seven comes from inside and strikes the agent. Shots 8, 9, and 10 come from overhead. Eleven and 12 come from inside. 13 comes from out in the yard. Fourteen comes from below the roof. And 15 makes three holes at once from the inside. There are at least six separate weapons firing in this scene. The gun the agent on the roof is firing, the gun that fires the single shots from inside, the gun that shoots 2 3-round single shots from inside, the gun firing from overhead, the gun firing from below the roof, and the gun firing from out in the yard. These weapons should not sound alike, and they should not sound the same distance from the camera. Now listen to this scene with the audio as it was released by KWTX Television in Waco, Texas. You can hear the sound of the grenade exploding, but after that, the bullet sounds are virtually identical, and there are places in the tape where there is absolute total silence, or the background noise cuts in and out, all signs of heavy editing. In this 3D computer wire illustration, you can see the trajectory of bullets 2, 8, 9, and 10 from overhead, showing that the bullets came from almost directly above. It will be important later on to know the locations of various objects in the yard. Here we see a gray shed where three agents will be seen later. This is a blue tarp covering equipment near the house. These are storage tanks out in the yard. One of the Branch Davidians buildings was a high tower located here. The camera filming all these scenes was located approximately here, way out in the yard, using a long telephoto lens. On March 5th, the ATF released a detailed story to the Dallas Morning News, complete with diagrams and descriptions of where the four agents who were killed had died. ATF's story and diagrams showed that all three of the agents who had gone in that window had died inside that room. Unfortunately for ATF, Keith Constantino was later interviewed by Current Affair, and Constantino described three, not four, agents who went onto the roof and into the window. He said he was one of the three agents. He says he made it out the window and down the ladder. He says two other agents were killed, but he doesn't say where. After Waco, the Big Lie was released in June 1993, the ATF began claiming that none of the agents who went into the window were killed. The story the ATF comes up with for the final report claims there were actually two groups of agents going into two windows on the same wall. The ATF claims there was a three-man team entering the east window and a four-man team entering the west window. Keith Constantino is listed in the Treasury report as having been on the three-man team. The agents who were killed are listed in the Treasury report as having been on the four-man team. Four agents can plainly be seen on the west side of the roof at all times. So yes, Constantino's team made it off the roof safely, but three of the men on the west side of the roof were killed. In this letter from Ronald K. Noble, answering a congressman's questions, Ronald Noble says, none of the three agents who went into the compound through the second-story window were killed. The review found that the fourth agent neither fired his weapon into the room nor threw any grenades, diversionary devices, or any other item into the room. Conway LeBlue and Todd McKeon were on that roof. They weren't on Constantino's team, and they were killed. These photos of the ATF evacuating men from the roof were taken after a ceasefire was called after the Branch Davidians called 911. And in the scenes of agents being removed from the roof, one agent's body can be plainly seen where it fell, a trail of blood streaming down the roof. Watch this scene carefully. First, you hear someone call Keith, and Keith answers, yeah, from the blue area. Was this Keith Constantino who fell to the ground from the roof? Shots are fired. A clank is heard. Notice that there had been a pry bar on the roof a few minutes earlier, and that this clank could have been the result of this pry bar being knocked off the roof by an agent getting out of the window. A cameraman, apparently referring to the helicopters, comments that there are two of them right over our heads. Shots are fired from the blue area again.
Cameraman!
Ambulance! Got it!
The camera is shooting through the base of the storage tanks toward the blue tarp-covered area. The telephoto lens often makes objects appear closer together than they really are, as you can see here. This is a blue tarp covering equipment near the house. These are storage tanks out in the yard. The camera filming all these scenes was located approximately here. The other agents you saw earlier were located here, climbing up ladders on this side of the house. This agent, shown where he was shot down on the roof, was probably shot by his own men from below. The trajectory of the bullets here are in direct line with the direction in which he fell. The four agents who were killed that day were Conway LeBlue, Todd W. McKeon, Robert J. Williams, and Stephen D. Willis. Three of the four agents who were killed that day had been President Clinton's bodyguards during his presidential campaign. Clinton himself stated this in his address to the Treasury on March 18, 1993, and named these agents by name. The new head of the ATF is now John McGaw, himself the former head of the Secret Service and in charge of presidential bodyguards. Two of the agents who were killed that day, Todd McKeon and Conway LeBlue, had appeared 18 months prior to the raid on the television program 48 Hours in a segment about the ATF. In the official report, all of the agents who were killed have an asterisk next to their names in the report. The asterisk means that none of these agents was treated at a hospital, but instead all were treated by a private physician. Not only did these agents have multiple wounds, but three of them had virtually identical wounds, a shot to the left temple that exited through the rear of the head, professional execution style. The autopsy on one of these agents also says a bullet fragment consistent with a 7.62 round was removed. A 7.62 NATO round is the same bullet fired by the machine gun in the helicopter you saw earlier. It would appear that someone in the government wanted to be certain these men were real dead. The autopsy notes that one of the agents suffered a deadly wound to the throat and a cut lip, which the coroner's notes attribute to an attempted field tracheotomy. Yet at trial, Nizan Pirwani, the doctor in charge of the autopsies of these agents, said this was a bullet hole. Interestingly, this particular coroner has been sued numerous times for such things as leaving a person on the table for an hour and a half before realizing the person was alive, and losing a woman's larynx, the portion of the neck most crucial to the strangulation death he was investigating. Yet he was the coroner upon which the investigation of the most heinous crimes in America would depend. It gets worse. Another part of the Treasury report says, Special Agents Bernadette Griffin, Jonathan Zimmer, and Martin Roy were pinned down behind a shed when Special Agent Jordan, who had been wounded in the arms room, staggered over to where they were and collapsed on them. Special Agent Griffin discovered that Jordan's arm was bleeding profusely. She elevated his arm and compressed the wound with her hand until the ceasefire 90 minutes later. These are the scenes that the ATF report was supposedly just describing. These agents aren't pinned down behind a shed, and they are not dodging bullets either. The agent on the ground is half in, half out of a body bag. He did not stagger to that position from any place wearing a body bag, and he is laying there stone cold, unattended by anyone in this scene. The other agents are merely trying to hide him from the camera. According to the final report, agents from the Dallas and Houston SRTs were supposed to enter the front door and clear the chapel. If agents were actually inside the chapel, as the plan called for, it is easy to see how agents were injured by shrapnel and shot, because we found this footage of yet another ATF agent throwing in not one, but two grenades, and shooting into that very chapel. Watch the holes that appear in the glass to tell the difference. Now we will show this again in slow motion. Many of the injuries the ATF received that day were shrapnel wounds. When the Branch Davidians called 911, they were connected with Lieutenant Lynch at the Waco Police Department, and Lieutenant Lynch was connected to government agents who were in the house across the street from the Branch Davidians.
This Lynch. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Yeah, this is Lieutenant Lynch. May I help you?
Lieutenant Lynch is with the Sheriff's Department and has no jurisdiction or authority at the Waco Police Department. One agent who was in the house across the street from Mount Carmel is identified only as Dino and as a state trooper. If he really is a state trooper, then why isn't he identified by full name? Dino leaves the phone for a minute, and he says...
I'm gonna hang on here for a second. I'm gonna let you talk to my partner here, Starlane Riddle, okay?
Starlane?
Yeah, Starlane Riddle. I'm gonna put her on the phone just while I'm looking to try and get a ride over there.
Okay.
Hang on.
Hey, Lynch. How's it going, pal?
Everything wonderful.
Good. Yeah. Good. Just hang in there. You're doing a great job.
We're hanging. Everything is okay on this end so far.
Okay. Does it sound pretty calm?
It does right now.
Okay.
Does right now. Everything's okay. They've asked for the news media, and they're worried about the chopper. So if we can get those choppers stopped, and also, Starlane, if and when those chopper, the medevac starts back in there, please let me know so I can advise them, because this seems to be a real sticky point with them.
Okay. They're still at the hospital, as far as I know, with the two that they took off with.
Rita Riddle, who is listed as a witness for the government in the trial, lived at Mount Carmel, as did her brother Jimmy, who was killed in the fire, and her sister-in-law, Ruth Riddle. Are either of these women Starlane Riddle? Another lie of interest is that the government claims to have recorded the telephone calls the day of the raid at the Waco police station when the Branch Davidians dialed 911. But listen as David Koresh dials 911. You can hear the 911 tones on the telephone.
Okay. 911.
Just a minute. David Koresh here. Just a moment.
Okay. Here's David.
The police station didn't record this when the call came in. This recording could only have come from a tap on David Koresh's phone line. There was no warrant to tap the Branch Davidians' telephone. This is a violation of Federal Law 18 U.S.C. 2510, and yet another lie. Mike Schroeder, along with Woody Kendricks and Norman Allison, had gone to work the morning of the raid and heard about the raid on the radio. They quickly tried to return home. They were stopped at the roadblock that had been set up by state troopers. Obviously, they would have been searched before these troopers would allow them to enter, and if they were presenting any sort of threat, the troopers would have arrested them on the spot. Instead, the troopers allowed them to pass the roadblock and walk towards home. Mike Schroeder never made it. He was shot 7 times in the back. He wasn't even on the Branch Davidian property. He was some 300 yards away. His autopsy describes his wounds as having been made from distant sniper shots. However, the official ATF report claims that ATF agents approached the men and identified themselves, and that the 3 men began firing at ATF. Doesn't this sound familiar by now? The account we have just provided is from an account written by the government's own agent in the probable cause affidavit filed against Woody Kendricks and Norman Allison, who were indicted by the government for conspiracy to commit murder. Yet the report released to the news media by the ATF and the ATF's official report still claim that these men were trying to shoot their way out of Mount Carmel. Mike's wife and child were inside the house. He had been trying to go home when he was killed. Mike Schroeder's body was left outside for 5 days before it was retrieved with a grappling hook and carried off in a helicopter like a side of beef on a meat hook. In reading the report, each time the ATF is criticized for something it did not do, but should have done, it appears to be merely a cover-up of what they did in fact do. Examples. The ATF is criticized for losing the element of surprise, which we have seen was not even an issue. The ATF is criticized for not using customs helicopters, who could have provided better communications, and the ability to fire from the helicopter. The ATF is criticized because they didn't have and couldn't use automatic weapons fire. The ATF had plenty of automatic weapon fire. Of special significance is a part of the report that says, a superior solution would have been to gain the advice of the Army's Delta Force. Has it come to this in the United States of America that federal agents investigating a tax violation are complaining because they needed machine guns, special forces military training, and tanks to raid a church? Conveniently, the Waco Tribune Herald began a series of scandalous articles the day before the raid on Mount Carmel. In these articles, the Tribune made the claims we were to hear repeated over and over in the media thereafter, that David Koresh abused children, that he had multiple wives, and that he believed he was God. The source for these stories, no matter whether it was the Waco Tribune Herald telling them or the national television networks, were always the same handful of people. The gents from Australia. The Toms from Australia. Victorine Hollingsworth from England had been inside Mount Carmel during the siege. Surprisingly, she was allowed to leave Mount Carmel and return to England while the siege was still going on. Robin Bunns is a former Branch Davidian member who had a child by David Koresh. This child would be Koresh's only known surviving heir, standing to inherit Koresh's sizable estate. Robin Bunns' mother also claimed to have been one of Koresh's lovers. Robin and her mother are the primary sources for the claims that Koresh had a harem of women. Mark Bro and his wife, originally from Hawaii, but living in Australia. Mark Bro was the source of the original allegations of child molestation. He claimed that he had personally seen a young girl leave David Koresh's bedroom. He also claimed to have received intensive weapons training at Mount Carmel. Mark Bro is legally blind and has been legally blind for a long time. David Jewell, whose ex-wife Sherry was inside Mount Carmel, became active in supporting allegations of child abuse when Mark Bro volunteered to help him get custody of his daughter, Carrie Jewell, by testifying at a custody battle hearing. These were the people that we saw over and over in the media as support for the government's stories that the Branch Davidians were some evil cult. Mark Bro is the person who contacted the State Department and the Cult Awareness Network and relayed his allegations. Cult Awareness Network, known by its initials, CAN, targets religious groups around the world for hate campaigns in the media. CAN members always make the same allegations against each group they attack, perverted sex, child abuse, and brainwashing. It reads like a worn-out script. It has been repeated so many times against so many different groups. Can receives funding through the Anti-Defamation League. The Anti-Defamation League was recently indicted in California and Virginia for illegal spying on United States citizens and engaging in covert information gathering activities in conjunction with law enforcement personnel. By saying what Can wants to hear, disgruntled former members quickly enlist Can's aid and the media's ear. At the urging of these former members, it was Can who had complained to Texas authorities that the Branch Davidians were abusing children. Even Sheriff Harwell of Waco knew that these allegations had already been investigated twice and found to be baseless.
There was really no evidence of child abuse. It was only allegations. And again, I say today that we have not ever found any proof of any child abuse out there.
Rick Ross, one of the Cult Awareness Network's so-called deprogramming experts, had continuous access to FBI negotiators. Shown here is an example of Rick Ross's expertise as a deprogrammer. Rick Ross is a convicted jewel thief and is presently under indictment for kidnapping. He has no known credentials to support his claim as an expert, yet the FBI allowed him to advise on the course of negotiations while ignoring advice from numerous theologians and genuine psychological counselors. The media, without apology, became tabloid sensationalists, regurgitating what the government told them and parading the all-too-willing detractors before us to reinforce the lies. NBC has twice run this excerpt, the same edited scene of bullets coming out of the wall, claiming they obtained a home video called Waco the Big Lie from a man who lived outside the ruins at Mount Carmel.
Roadside vendors include John Ellis, who sells this home video using news footage in an attempt to prove there was a government conspiracy to get the Branch Davidians.
They showed this handwritten label to emphasize that it is a homemade video. Unfortunately, the handwriting on that label is Linda Thompson's handwriting, the chairman of the American Justice Federation. She handwrote the label when she sent a copy of the tape to NBC, the day American Justice Federation finished the tape. This proves that NBC had the tape since June, and not only has refused to show it, but is instead committing fraud to discredit it. Not only do we have press that cooperates with the government and lies to us, we found three instances where unlawful force, including deadly force, was used at Waco by the government to keep the press out. On the day of the raid, an unidentified reporter was beaten.
Get that camera out of here! Get out of here!
I need help! I am...
Move! Go!
This is an inexcusable and illegal abuse of the right of the free press. And why would the ATF risk beating this reporter in this manner? We can later see the body of an agent in a truck. This is the same body and truck that were later filmed leaving Mount Carmel in scenes shown on the news. What is interesting, however, is that there don't appear to be any other cars in the area as there were after the raid, so the time this scene was filmed is important to learning when this agent really died. When Linda Thompson was leaving the press area in Waco, she was stopped at one of the roadblocks and detained by this ATF agent, who kept an MP5 submachine gun, his finger on the trigger, pointed at her head in the car. She snapped this picture and hid the film before the ATF agent illegally searched the car. Another example of how the government deals with the free press that aren't hand-picked to tell you lies. And if the Branch Davidians, after being fired upon by helicopters, having their windows broken in, grenades thrown into their home, and ATF agents firing upon their children, did finally fire back, they have Texas law on their side, which says, Texas Penal Code, Subchapter C, Article 9.31, Self-Defense. The use of force to resist an arrest or search is justified if, before the actor offers any resistance, the peace officer uses or attempts to use greater force than necessary to make the arrest or search, and when and to the degree the actor reasonably believes the force is immediately necessary to protect himself against the peace officer's use of or attempted use of greater force than necessary. The FBI quickly moved in to seal Mount Carmel from the world. Before the day ended, an armored personnel carrier was brought in, and the Branch Davidians' communications were quickly cut off, making sure the world would not know the Branch Davidians' side of things. The FBI had no warrant allowing them to block any communications whatsoever, yet the Branch Davidians' phone lines were immediately cut off and routed directly to the FBI. This is a felony under Title 18 of the United States Code, Section 2511. The FBI knew the Branch Davidians had ham radio and CB equipment and jammed these communications illegally as well. Media was kept 2 miles away, and the only news the world would hear would be the official story told by Agent Bob Ricks of the FBI at a press conference each day at 10:30 a.m. in Waco, attended only by the press that the FBI allowed to enter. The Department of Justice report admits many of the things that millions of Americans saw with their own eyes in Waco, The Big Lie, a videotape produced by the American Justice Federation about what happened in Waco. The Department of Justice report admits that the Branch Davidians were tortured for 51 days and their property systematically destroyed. The night of March 21st and the early morning hours of March 22nd, the FBI cleared vehicles around the compound, played loud Tibetan chants on the loudspeakers, and used the external floodlights. Peter Gent was shot on top of the water tower. His body was left there for days. The government's report reflects that the government repeatedly refused the Branch Davidians' request to remove his body. The report admits that while we were being told the Branch Davidians wouldn't come out, the Branch Davidians were being told by the FBI that they could not come out. It admits that if anyone came out of the house, agents threw concussion grenades at them. On March 25, 1993, the negotiators told Schneider that no one would be allowed to come outside the compound. The Department of Justice independent investigation was no more independent than the Treasury report. Edward Dennis is an attorney who represents the government in various cases and had cases pending before the Department of Justice at the time he conducted the so-called independent investigation. Worse, he admits in the report, "I have primarily relied upon the record gathered by the department as the basis for the conclusions in this report, supplemented by a number of follow-up interviews." But he says he's satisfied that the factual inquiry by the department was conducted in a thorough and objective manner. We obtained a videotape made by one of the FBI SWAT teams. Due to time constraints, we can't include the whole tape, but you can obtain the entire 50-minute FBI SWAT team video from the American Justice Federation, which provides surprising intelligence information.
Here we are down in Waco, Texas. It's Monday afternoon. We just got in last night. Getting ready to be checked out on some helicopters here, because we're part of the helicopter assault team. You see the different Bureau birds here.
What
a camera. I wonder why I couldn't see anything.
We're a big goddamn trouble, boy.
Yeah.
Had the cap on.
Here we are.
Waco, Texas, baby.
Waco, Texas, Helicopter City, getting ready to go out on an operation here.
Yeah.
Training mission. You wait for the kid folks back home there, boys?
Oh, from Waco! Good party!
Getting ready to go. We're going up with an 8-man team, 4 people in each bird.
Yep.
See the triage tents, the medevac point here.
Can we shoot
you? Yeah, in a second. I'm going to get a long shot of Satellite City down there.
There they are. Boys getting ready to go.
Hey, put this gear here, will you?
Getting ready to go up in the bird here and take a look over the area.
We're getting out, right?
And then in case we do something, we're going to supply air cover, I guess. Whatever.
Was the FBI posture one of concern for the children? We found this candid interview with an FBI agent the morning of the fire particularly insightful.
Quite a specimen, I tell you. I just, in all my years involved with SWAT, I've never seen a gentleman like this that I've learned so much from in just the short time I've been around him. It's just awesome is about the only word to describe him.
Honed to a fine edge, honed to kill.
The techniques used on the Branch Davidians are well-known brainwashing techniques. cut off all communication with the outside world, all utilities, all food supplies, and subject the person to extreme stress. Lights, noise, tanks charging the windows, and constant propaganda on loudspeakers. As this tape segment from BBC reveals, various psychological weapons were available to the Justice Department and were examined for use on David Koresh.
Two Russian psychologists have been brought in from Moscow to demonstrate a technique for analyzing the human mind and then influencing it. The concept is that with an understanding of an individual's mind, keywords transmitted in music or white noise will force that person to obey. The FBI examined the system to use against David Koresh at Waco in Texas.
CNN said.
And they used some intangible tools, analysis of voice patterns, deviant behavior analysis, different kinds of tools that allow them to develop their confidence with the person they're dealing with.
In November, Janet Reno was a speaker at a secret conference on this type of mind control weapon and other so-called non-lethal weapons, including weapons such as laser guns designed to blind, extremely low-level sound waves that can cause violent debilitation, and microwave radiation weapons. This in the United States of America. How many of these weapons were actually tested on the Branch Davidians? The FBI SWAT team video captured the sounds of one of these psychological warfare devices.
Here we are. It's Wednesday afternoon. We're here at the Y intersection. It's a checkpoint at the Y. It's Agent Meredith. See the Davidian compound is straight up ahead there.
Tell everybody what that noise is.
I don't know if you can hear the noise on this tape, but that's some of the noise being made up there by the compound. You hear a helicopter off in the distance there.
This footage is from the FBI SWAT team video. It was a piece of equipment used by the FBI. We have included this footage in hopes that someone can identify what it is. Let's watch that again in slow motion. As much as 10 days prior to the fire, a government agent is seen testing the wind using a smoke grenade. The government, as usual, claims this too is a Branch Davidian. If so, it is a Branch Davidian dressed in a dress shirt and slacks who casually meanders around the yard about 50 yards from the house in full view of the armed federal agents surrounding the house. What of the final day of the fire? A fire break was cleared by the tanks completely around the house. A fire break is a clear area, free of brush and debris, to keep a fire from spreading outside the cleared area. This fire break is easily seen in the overhead picture of the house after tanks cleared out the bushes and cars.
Here, we have slowly taken away everything around that complete compound.
The Department of Justice report admits that tear gas was inserted into all windows of the compound through the Mark V's, in the two CEVs, as well as by ferret rounds launched from the Bradley vehicles. Ferret grenades are 40-millimeter mortar rounds which would easily kill anyone the rounds would hit. And the gas used wasn't tear gas. The Justice Department has now admitted it was CS gas, a gas banned for use in wartime by a treaty signed by the United States in January 1993. It is a gas that, according to the manufacturer, should never be used indoors, ever. Perhaps these 55-gallon drums of kerosene, and whatever this other substance in the black drums with red stripes is, provide the answer to what was really used that day. The FBI SWAT team says these drums belong to the FBI hostage response team. As these shocking pictures show, the FBI hostage rescue team had set up a sniper nest in the barn outside the house. Sandbags lined the walls, and rifle turret holes have been made in the walls to sniper fire out at people. A match-grade ammunition box, a high-quality ammunition used by skilled snipers, is on the ground. Someone has made marks on the wall like you might see made when a gunslinger makes notches in his gun for each kill. The FBI SWAT team film shows us the sniper positions in a barn out back of Mount Carmel.
Bonnie Nestor's house in Oak Ridge.
It's the entrance to the garage. This back room is a sleeping and eating quarters.
Nestor?
As well as a weapons storage area. Directly ahead is a tarp leading to one of the three sniper positions.
During the morning of the fire and throughout the day, reporters announced that up to 20 people had been seen escaping before the fire. 21 people were found shot.
With our long-range camera, we did see some people scurrying out. We couldn't tell how many. It was shortly after that that we heard that there were 20 people who had come out. It was after that that we heard from the Justice Department over the wires that they were saying there were only 8. They are probably being careful and understating things for the beginning. Let's hope so.
Listen to the FBI SWAT team tape as the fire burns. Shots can be heard from nearby and echoing off the house. That means the shots were being fired at the house, not from the house. One reporter heard a gunshot in the distance, which can clearly be heard on camera, too.
Did you hear that? I don't know.
The independent fire investigator, Paul Gray, formerly had an office in the ATF building for 10 years. He carried a card that said ATF Fire Investigator on it. His wife is employed as a secretary for the ATF, and he attended the funeral of one of the dead ATF agents. He found that persons inside the house started the fire. This now well-known scene of a flame-throwing tank was shown in Waco, The Big Lie, and occurred at approximately 11:40 a.m. the morning of the fire. Another tank is around back of the house shortly after the flame-throwing tank was seen out front. You can see flames coming from this tank, too. There is no smoke coming from the front of the house yet. Shortly afterwards, smoke is seen coming from the back wall where the flame-throwing tank had been a few minutes earlier. White smoke billows from around the tank in back. Soon, the entire back is engulfed in smoke. The front window was the last of these three fires to begin burning. At the same time as fire was already breaking out in the back of the house, as you just saw, a tank was at the front door. As this tank backs out, flame can be seen shooting from the front of it. Let's look at that again. The tank then goes to the side. As the tank withdraws, it appears to have a human being speared on the end of the gun, which it quickly shoves back into the building. As it withdraws the gun again, boards snap off, obscuring what appears to be a body from view. Notice, however, that the board and the back of the body, or whatever it is, are on fire. We'll show that again. FBI agent R.J. Craig testified at trial that he was driving this tank. Not surprisingly, he's also the person who claims to have seen a Branch Davidian inside start the fire. In an interview conducted by a private individual at the ruins of Mount Carmel with one of the men who was driving a tank the day of the fire, the tank driver said he saw what appeared to be an FBI agent inside the house.
Tell me what happened the day of the Mount Carmel fire.
Well, the guard got the orders early in the morning, the evening of the 16th, that we were to come down here to mobilize. On the morning of the 19th, as you all know, we started a bombardment by the orders of the Attorney General and the FBI and ATF, saying that this had to be taken immediately. Their story was they were supposed to help these people out and then save as many as they can.
I'm going to have to get this right up here because the wind's blowing it so hard.
The issue orders were to, of course, shoot tear gas into the buildings. We were supposed to hit it from four corners of the compound, and after we hit the order, there was a sign about, I guess it was about 11 something that morning when we saw the fire start at one of the southeast corners, and we saw somebody wearing a black outfit similar to ATF and FBI, but you know, we can't say what it was.
Did you see the letters FBI on it by any chance?
What I saw, letters which looked like it, is all I can tell you, because you're looking from a little porthole, you know. And after that, it was just amazing. The whole thing just went up.
Both the interviewer and the tank driver's identities are known to us, but we are keeping that information confidential for their safety. At trial, an FBI hostage response team agent, Kenneth Lancaster, claimed to have seen a Branch Davidian who looked like Elvis. Perhaps he was referring to this agent on the roof. Lettering is barely discernible on the back of his jacket. He also has a device of some kind larger than a gas mask. As he jumps down from the roof and walks away, his head and hair appear quite tall from the fireproof Nomex hood he was wearing. This is similar to a type of fireproof hood sold in police catalogs, shown here. As the fire burns, watch as this tank backs out and the area above the gun simultaneously begins to burn. We'll play that again. A tank can be seen through the trees, shooting flames to light a portion of the building that isn't burning. Let's look at that again in slow motion. Before, during, and after the fire, agents can be seen coming and going around the house. The Justice Department referred only to combat engineer vehicles, called CEVs, when asked to explain the flame-throwing tanks last October. Janet Reno said that CEV-1 and CEV-2 had no flame-throwing equipment and had been inspected by the investigators. She neglected to mention that the Justice Department report says CEV-2 broke down, and the team of that vehicle obtained another CEV which was not equipped for tear gas. It fails to mention what it was equipped with, though. And the report doesn't mention at all the other tanks and CEVs and equipment they were carrying that day either. This is a picture of an M67 flame-throwing tank from Jane's Armor and Artillery 1979-80 edition, which military experts have identified as one of the types of tanks present that day. One of the characteristics of this tank is that it has a fake barrel extension on the end of the gun to disguise the flamethrower. This tank, parked alongside the ruins after the fire, seems to fit the bill. It has had a bulldozer blade and a boom arm attached to it. Notice the charring on the front, too. Besides that, in the Department of Justice report, the government absolutely, positively, and unequivocally asserts that it did not accidentally set the fire by knocking over any lanterns. Someone was certainly worried that the public was learning the truth. The government was taking a serious beating from public outrage after Waco, the Big Lie, was released.
And we've seen an example of police state America in what happened at Waco when they used flame-throwing tanks and CS gas against American citizens, which is against the United States law.
If the federal agents are charged with murder or even if there's an investigation.
Let me let people know that we will have a complete showing as soon as we go off the air.
Stand Up America, this is Dave Frank and welcome.
Going in the senator's office to inform the senator of the facts.
Do you think that three of these agents were killed by so-called friendly fire or killed by another agent himself?
Sir,
that is indicated on a film that's been shown.
There's no evidence of that, that they do not believe that any of them were killed by friendly fire, that it all came out of the compound.
You don't believe this video film that's being shown around indicates that?
No, I do not, and the investigation does not concur with that.
There was a discussion about the Linda Thompson video leading to speculation in some quarters that the government either inadvertently or by design ignited the fire at the compound. The report deals with that video in some detail and dismisses that speculation. It draws no conclusions on the video. It appears to show flames coming from the front of the tank. If those aren't flames, what are they? What's your conclusion on that?
We've seen the video, and obviously it raised our eyebrows and caused the same concern with us as it did with, I'm sure, any of you that have seen it. We have submitted the video for expert analysis to the to a university, a local university at the University of Maryland. I can only tell you what they've told us preliminarily, and so that this is very preliminary. First of all, as I'm sure you'll see in the report, is the vehicles were not outfitted with any type of flamethrowing capability. Secondly, is that the only way that a flame could have come from the front would have been through some type of busted hydraulic line or something like that. We looked for that. We did not find that. Yet, hang on just a second, yet you still see something. I'll be the first one to concede that. You see something. We have asked the experts to take a look at it and to come back with another independent assessment, which you will get. That's forthcoming, because we only got the tape kind of late on in this whole process. The preliminary assessments are, and I want to stress preliminary, are that there were dispersal agents that were used to disperse the gas. And when I say gas, really, CS gas is not truly a gas. It's a particulate. And so it's like a powder that falls on an area and spreads out. It takes a dispersal agent to then project it into an area. The dispersal agent used in this was a gas, carbon monoxide and something else, that was heavier than air. And so what you see on the video is, instead of seeing a flame rise, which you would expect because of the heat, you see something drop. And the preliminary opinions are that is the dispersal agent, which is, by the way, is questionable whether that's flammable, but the general consensus is it's non-flammable. And apparently that is a light, perhaps it's dust, perhaps it's a defect in terms of the way the video was taken, and it's the dispersal agent falling to the ground. Yes, sir.
Some people at R&D, military sources I've showed that video to, have told me that that's not a conventional vehicle, that it was, to use their words, jury-rigged at Fort Hood for the express mission at hand in Waco.
That's generally true.
Is that correct?
It was. It's a boom that was rigged. There were two vehicles. It was CEV, Combat Engineering Vehicle 1 and 2. CEV 1 was rigged with a boom to be able to insert gas into the second level, CEV 1 into the first level.
Are there any safety parameters and performance standards established for that vehicle before it was taken to the site?
I'm not sure how to answer your question on that one. I mean, did this boom in any way alter the vehicle's already known safety standards? Is, to the best of my knowledge, the answer to that is no. It in no way altered.
Contributed or possibly caused an ignition source because they didn't know its performance standards.
We looked to that, and that's what we addressed in the report. We had the people take a close look at that vehicle, the very same one. We saw no problems, no indication of fire, first of all, and we saw no busted fuel lines, no change capabilities. We looked very carefully at that vehicle, and we saw nothing like that.
You don't think that was flame at the front of that tube in the video?
I don't know what it is. I have to be honest with you. I, at this moment, I don't know what it is.
There's other video that's taken from... Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
And let me say one more thing just to finalize that. The fire did not start at that location, and that video that you saw was taken approximately 30 to 45 minutes before the fire began, and the fire did not start at that location.
The nagging trail of implication to Special Forces just keeps popping up. Soldier of Fortune magazine claimed the flames on the flamethrowing tank were mere reflections. This magazine's principal advisor is Colonel Beckwith, founder of Delta Force, and the editor, Robert K. Brown, is former Delta Force as well. Reed Irvine of Accuracy in Media made the bald-faced claim that the flamethrowing tank in Waco the Big Lie was doctored. He declined an offer to have the footage analyzed. He, too, writes for Soldier of Fortune magazine. Bo Greitz, former Special Forces and a self-proclaimed patriot, was the first to claim the flames on the tank in Waco the Big Lie were just a reflection from debris and that the CS gas caused the fire. Tom Donahue and Ron Engelman, radio announcers who were fans of Bo Greitz, made the same claims, as did Carl Wigglesworth of WOAI Radio in San Antonio. Wigglesworth brought in James Pate of Soldier of Fortune to ambush Linda Thompson on a radio program. 2 weeks before the Branch Davidians trial, a tape suddenly surfaced that claims to show that the scene you just saw was only debris on the tank, not fire, and that the fire was accidentally set because the tanks accidentally knocked down a gymnasium wall, causing a collapse of the gymnasium, knocking over a lantern. We call this the Mrs. O'Leary's cow theory of the fire. Soldier of Fortune magazine, in its February 1994 issue, touts this tape and reproduces these pictures. In the first infrared picture from the tape, which Soldier of Fortune claims proves the gym was collapsed before the fire began, There is an arrow pointing to an area where the tape claims that half the gymnasium appears to be gone. However, under the letter A, there should be another building, but that building is gone too. Between the front of the house and the gym, there should be four other buildings, but they are missing too. And look at the area where the gymnasium is supposedly collapsed. There's no roof line, no outline of the foundation, nothing. Only what looks like rubble bits. This picture doesn't show a collapsed gymnasium. It shows a completely missing gymnasium, just like the other five supposedly missing buildings. The second infrared picture, taken a few minutes later, is taken from a different angle. The building that was missing under the letter A in the first picture is now visible. All of the buildings between the front of the house and the gymnasium are visible, too. What caused the gymnasium to disappear and all these other buildings to disappear is distortions in the infrared film and clouds between the source camera and the building. There's no mystery and no missing gym either. Soldier of Fortune claims their experts agree with this tape. Some experts. And the O'Leary's cow tape claims that the fire began in the gym and that there was a natural progression of the fire. As these easy-to-see pictures clearly show, the gymnasium was one of the last buildings to catch fire, and it is still plainly standing more than 20 minutes after the fire starts. This is a full view of the buildings in the early morning before the fire started. The gymnasium is the building with the A-shaped roofline. Notice the A-shaped roofline is facing you. The O'Leary's Cow Tape and Soldier of Fortune magazine, page 4, show us this picture as proof that the gym was collapsed. Notice that you see sky below the left edge of the building and nothing behind it. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to see that there are serious problems with this enhanced picture. The O'Leary's Cow Tape also tries to prove that the flames seen on the front of this tank aren't flames, but are merely a reflection from debris. The O'Leary's Cow Tape does this by showing this heavily digitized footage. Notice how much better quality the picture seems than the original. This is impossible without computer enhancement. The source for the pictures publicly admitted that he had digitized the pictures. Even in the O'Leary's Cow Tape digitized picture, though, the flame can be seen while the tank is still in shadow. No reflection can create a light source in shadow. And better yet, the government's infrared pictures show a tank out in the yard at exactly the right time that plainly has a bright, hot spot across the entire end. Like fire, maybe? And in the O'Leary's Cow Tape, they ignored these proofs of the flamethrower visible in their own footage. So who has a motive to cover up here? Some congressmen tried to get answers after Waco, the big lie, came out. They were assured that there was no direct military involvement in the siege. It is illegal to use military against U.S. citizens under the Posse Comitatus Act, 18 U.S.C. 1385. These answers to congressmen claim that military equipment, training, and support may be provided to law enforcement under another law, 10 U.S.C. 372. However, even this law forbids active participation by the military. The replies these congressmen received were assurances that there was no direct military involvement and that no Army equipment was loaned with operable weapons systems. Active Army forces did not operate helicopters, tanks, or other armored vehicles, nor were such forces actively or directly involved in actual law enforcement operations. No one but an experienced member of the military could have fired these mortar shots in this pattern. Shown here is one of those so-called inoperable weapons systems delivering one of those 40-millimeter rounds. The FBI SWAT team video shows this Marine with an FBI agent.
We're just here to help.
Here to take them.
The FBI SWAT team video, plainly shows active duty military gassing the tanks and preparing to get in the tanks the morning of the fire.
Here we are refueling the Bear Adleys. Problems at all, no. See the back of the Bradley?
One more day at this motherfucker, not back now. Yeah. Too many chiefs out here.
And here, active duty military are plainly flying the FBI helicopter and Army evacuation helicopters.
We're going up with an 8-man team, 4 people in each bird.
Here is one of those so-called inoperable weapons systems. After the fire, we have several scenes that show active duty military emerging from the tanks. Many are wearing dark maroon berets, just like those consulting 7th Army Special Forces from Fort Bragg wear. This is a portable flamethrower, which was used in World War II and in Vietnam, particularly to blast underground bunkers. The tanks are worn on the agents' backs, similar to what can be seen in these pictures during the siege at Waco. A better view of this type of outfit is seen as an agent gets out of a tank. The camera cut away here, but when it returned, the agent is being assisted by another agent. In this scene, two agents obviously are dragging what appears to be a body, but this does not appear to be a rescue. As they reach the far side of the tank, you can see that one of the agents has a portable tank on his back and engages in a spraying motion. Suddenly, fire flares up. This is a thermite bomb. Variations are known as incendiary grenades. It explodes on impact and burns with extremely high, intense heat made of either phosphorus or magnesium. After the fire is nearly out at Mount Carmel, agents approach the concrete building that used to be inside the house. An explosion can be heard, and flames and smoke erupt from the concrete building. Notice that the agents don't take cover or run away as they would if this had been an unexpected explosion. In any crime scene, great care is ordinarily taken to preserve evidence, yet during the fire at Mount Carmel, tanks constantly pushed debris into the fire. Afterwards, the entire area was bulldozed and all the underground tunnels were filled in. And continuing to show the same careful regard for the preservation of evidence as demonstrated earlier, and with a total lack of respect for the humanity lost at Mount Carmel, an agent relieves himself in the ashes beneath one of the tanks that was used to destroy the Branch Davidians. Ironically, that night, as Mount Carmel still smoldered, President Clinton spoke in Washington, D.C. at a dedication of the Holocaust Museum, dedicated to the people tortured and murdered by the Nazis in Germany. It is especially ironic that the Branch Davidians were attacked the same day, 50 years later, that the Nazis had attacked the Warsaw Ghetto in Germany. And it was 50 years to the day after the Nazis burned the Warsaw Ghetto that Mount Carmel was burned to the ground. As Bill Clinton commemorated the memorial, he said,
"The Holocaust began when the most civilized country of its day unleashed unprecedented acts of cruelty and hatred, abetted by perversions of science, philosophy, and law. A culture which produced Goethe, Schiller, and Beethoven, then brought forth Hitler and Himmler, the merciless hordes who themselves were educated as others who were educated stood by and did nothing. Millions died for who they were, how they worshiped, what they believed, and who they loved."
Was he talking about Nazi Germany, or was he talking about Waco, Texas in 1993?